a little earlier than I thought. It's only 6:05. We've got a good 40 minutes here to talk. That's going to be fun. I just wanted to thank both Dr. Litfin and Dr. Howard for being here this evening. The topic is leadership. And both these men have a wide-ranging experience in terms of leadership. And I wonder if you could just give us a little taste of that, both perhaps in your professional life, but also in your personal life.
Well, I can make this very quick. I spent my 30s as a professor at Dallas Theological Seminary. I spent my 40s as the senior pastor of a church, very much like the college church in Tennessee. And then as I was turning 50, I wound up at the college for 17 years as the president of Wheaton College. I think my greatest leadership experience, however, is my family. Where I learned the most about leadership, other than in the crucible of doing it and making mistakes and regretting them and trying to do it better next time, was the 5 years that I spent when I was at Dallas Seminary as a professor in the Department of Pastoral Ministries under the leadership of Haddon Robinson. Haddon was the chair of the department, dear friend, colleague, mentor. And I had the privilege of working under Haddon, under his direction. I watched him and how he led that department. And ever after that, whether I was in the church or at the college here, I would find myself doing things or saying things, and it would occur to me, that's the way Haddon would have done that. And I realized that I had learned lifelong lessons that I didn't even know I was learning in that 5 years that I worked with Haddon in the department.
Well, Duane, I think you speak rightly when you say leadership really is something that occurs in the home, in the context of family. I've been a professor most of my adult career, spent some time in healthcare administration, spent some time in banking. But I think every time I get in front of my students, and think about where we're going. I sort of envision teaching as a leadership activity, as taking a journey with my students and trying to help us land in a good place. And then participating on various boards, watching other people serve, watching Dr. Litfin serve so ably at Wheaton College. I've spent a fair amount of time watching leaders and trying to understand what that looks like.
That's brilliant. Thank you so much, man. It is a real privilege to have this evening together talking about this subject. And I've got some questions that I would like to ask them, but of course, I could probably do that offline. And yet, at the same time, there are things I want to tease out as we talk here. Many of you sent in emails or been on my Facebook page and given your questions, so we have a whole list of those as well. Some of them come in particular categories, so we may tease out some of those categories. Some of them are really quite specific, and we'll get to those as well, you know, but in a good way specific. Duane, you mentioned Haddon Robinson, well known to me and probably to many of us. Just tell us what it was about Haddon Robinson that struck you in terms of leadership. I think of him as a Bible scholar. And of course, Bible scholars can be leaders too. Can you just give us in a sentence what it was that you said, okay, that's a leader I want to be like? What was it?
Haddon was strong. He knew where he was going. We all recognized he was out ahead of us, more mature and wiser than we were. He's a generation older than me. But he also, it was the way he worked with us. He never pulled rank. It wasn't a power operation. It was a modeling operation. We deferred to him because we respected him. He deserved that respect. And he honored us and respected us and led us and drew the best out of us. So much of leadership it might be wise just to try somewhere along here at the outset to define what we mean by leadership. Leadership is really so location or situation specific. what you need from a surgeon in the operating theater is very different than what you need from a small group leader in the church. I mean, those are very different kind of roles, and yet we call them both leadership. There are different tactics. There are different skills that are needed in different situations, but there probably is some sort of essence to this business of leadership, and we might do well to see if we could get that on the table and then talk about all the variety of ways that essence shows itself. That makes sense?
Absolutely, it does. Let's tease that out then a little bit. The definition of leadership specific. Dr. Howard, how would you define leadership for us?
I'm glad you raised that. I firmly believe that if you're a follower of Jesus, that part of being a follower of Jesus is being ready and willing to pick up that mantle of leadership when God asks you to do so. I do believe that in some cases, leadership is definitely comes with a role. You have a president of the United States, you have a president of a college, you're the senior pastor, and those are definitely leadership roles. But I agree with you, Duane, very much so that leadership for Christians is contextual and it's seasonal. And any time God has a group of people that are here that God wants to move to this place in their life, he calls upon somebody to pick up that mantle of responsibility and say, I will do what I can to help that group get to the destination where God wants them. And that group might be little two-year-olds in the nursery. And you watch people who are very, very adept at ministering to 2 and 3 year olds. And then you look at some of the best leadership literature, and what's being done well there, that's what the leadership literature is talking about. And I think one of the reasons we're talking about leadership is because there's so much work in the world that needs to get done that isn't getting done, because followers of Jesus are waiting for somebody else to lead. And it's I don't think there's been a really good leader ever that's felt adequate or trained enough or strong enough or smart enough or wise enough. And that's why God tells us he delights working in weak vessels, because he sees the glory. So while Pastor Moody is talking to Dr. Litfin and myself, this is, if I could have you hear one thing, this is something for all of us, and it will be contextual, it will be seasonal, but there'll be a time when there's a group of people that are lost, that need to get someplace, and God will say, would you do what you can to pick up that mantle of responsibility to help this group of people that God loves get from here to here? So that's how I think about leadership.
It's very helpful. I'm just thinking it through, and I think that's incredibly insightful and encouraging, because in a sense what you're saying then, Bruce, is that we all will have moments when that will come before us. Is that right?
I think it's part and parcel of being a follower of Jesus.
I find that very helpful, because I think there's a subtext in our culture, and maybe, Duane, you could step in here as well. The subtext in our culture, which is leadership is a bad thing, an authoritarian thing, a negative thing, a sort of power trip. And yet that's not what we're saying at all, because we follow Jesus as a leader, so there's leadership. And what would it be, how then would we define leadership in a Christian way, in a definitively Christian way, as a follower of Jesus?
Yeah, that touches on the whole subject of so-called servant leadership. Let me comment on what I've learned over a lifetime of doing and watching in situations where there's leadership taking place. for good or ill, having to do with the essence of leadership. Can I tell you a story?
Yeah. Please do. We love stories.
This is one of my favorite stories. I love the punchline of this. You probably won't, but I love the punchline, but there's more to it than that. This is a story that I heard years ago about General George Patton. He was near the end of the European Theater of War, and World War II was winding down, and he was having a conversation with General Omar Bradley. And Patton was complaining that he was soon going to be out of work, and Bradley said, no, you won't. MacArthur, who was the supreme commander of all the forces, MacArthur will put you to work in the Far East, which still had a lot to do. And Patton said, no, he won't. And Bradley said, well, why not? And General Patton proceeded to tell Bradley a story about World War I. When he was serving as Lieutenant Patton in the infantry under Captain MacArthur. And they were leading a company of men and been assigned to take this hill that was well fortified. And there came a point where they just had to take the hill. So they jumped to their feet and said, come on this way, and up the hill they go, the whole company going up the hill, and there comes this withering fire down the hill, and the entire company of men fell to the ground, hugging the ground, except for two men, Captain MacArthur and Lieutenant Patton. And all those years later, General Patton said to Omar Bradley, MacArthur never forgave me for that. Like I say, I like that. It takes a moment for that to settle in. I realize that, but I love that punchline. That's really a story about the ego of Douglas MacArthur. He didn't want to share the glory, and here was Patton right there still on his feet along with him, and it ticked him off. He wanted to be the only one. But what I like about that story is not just sort of that punchline. What I like about that story is it captures for me the essence of what leadership is. You can't lead from the middle. If you're in the middle of the pack doing what everybody else is doing, that's not leadership. You can't lead from behind. You can't be back there with a switch at the back of people's legs, moving the group forward and call that leadership. That's not leadership. You have to be up on your feet, moving forward, out ahead, and in one way or another saying, come on this way. And all the more as the fire can be hot and heavy sometimes in leadership. In one form or another, you need to be out ahead. Jesus is our model. He left us an example that we are to walk in his footsteps. He's out there ahead of us. Paul said, be imitators of me, even as I am imitator of Christ. People who are in leadership anywhere, but especially in the church, need to be people who are in some sense either knowledge or their godliness or their wisdom or the other giftedness they have from the Spirit. In one way or another, they are out ahead saying to others, come on, this way, I'll model it for you. We are to lead by our model in the local church, Peter says, not by lording it over to the pastors, the elders, but leading by your model. One way or another, there's some form of being out ahead, and it takes many different forms. There's in the literature on this that I worked with for years when I was at the university in my doctoral work, did a good deal of work in the area of leadership, and there are a series of studies, for example, a classic example, a plane full of passengers with the captain in the cockpit, and the captain is the leader. He's in charge of this whole thing, and his expertise and everything is very important to that whole group of people, that he's an effective leader and able to do what they need him to do as the one who's in charge of this situation. But for one reason or another, there's a failure, and that plane crashes into the jungle. And now this whole plane load of people is lost in the jungle. It's not guaranteed that captain is the right one to lead those people out of the jungle. There's a survival expert back there among the passengers before. He's going to be the leader because the situation has so changed. But one way or another, to be an effective leader, you have to be out front. It's not enough for a pastor simply to say, you people need to do this, scolding the congregation. No, there needs to be a sense of, we're in this together. The qualifications of the elder and the pastor are such that they are designed to draw out of the congregation or to be the marks of the ones the Lord is lifting up into leadership in the congregation, that they meet these criteria. the qualifications very clearly laid out in the pastoral epistles, the qualifications of leadership in the local church, especially at the pastor or elder level. You hear sometimes people say today in the church, I have to be careful because this sort of irritates me, so I want to not speak too strongly about it, but pastors who are eager as a way of identifying with our people to keep talking about how they're no different than anybody else and they've got all these faults and shortcomings and they love sort of wallowing in this, and you actually have people in the pew who say, oh, that's cool, that's somebody I can really, that's the kind of pastor I want, somebody who's just like me. I don't want a pastor who's just like me. I want a pastor who's out ahead of me, who's on his feet saying, come on, come on this way. He's not perfect. No pastor ever is, not even Josh. But there needs to be a sense in which the leader is out in front saying, come on this way, modeling for everyone else what needs. That's the essence of leadership. Now, that takes so many different forms, but in one way or another, whenever we come to someone who's actually doing leadership, some form of that is going to be what's going on.
I was thinking of C.S. Lewis's story when there's this person who wants to be a king or is going to be asked to be a king, and he doesn't really want to do it. And he's asked, you know, well, he doesn't feel qualified. And the story is, well, can you be first in a battle and last in retreat? And that's an interesting kind of way of encapsulating some of what you were saying there, which is really, really helpful, I think.
Up front, yeah.
We're going to get to some of these questions that we have right now. And Bruce, there's one which is, I think, you know, is directed straight at you. And so I'm just going to read it out. I was always impressed with Bruce's soft-spokenness and kindness. What strengths do you need to be a soft-spoken leader? Sorry, that's kind of embarrassing, isn't it? Because sort of, you know, here you are in front of everyone giving you some, but it's true, you know, how do you do that? How do you manage to lead, but at the same time have these qualities?
It's just because my belt is too tight. I can't,
yeah,
can't,
right, okay.
Can't breathe. I think probably in situations like this, I'm probably a little bit more soft-spoken. I think in my classes, I don't think my students would say I'm terribly soft-spoken. I tend to be fairly animated. And I think just part of that is just there's a lot of people, and I'm kind of shy and introverted. It's probably, I hope it comes just out of a sense of respect for the audience, in that whenever you're up here and you're talking, you're kind of the center of the public address system or the lights or whatever, it's, you wouldn't want to lose your way and think that the moment's about you when the idea is to magnify the Lord. And when I think about Psalm 34, where it says, oh, magnify the Lord with me, a magnifying glass makes something on the other side look larger than life. But the idea of a magnifying glass is that it's transparent, that you don't see that, you see what's on the other side of that. And so I would hope that is the image that I try to live by, and I embraced that probably 30 years ago. And there's some poetry that goes along with that. But the whole idea, magnify the Lord with me, is to be invisible. And what people see, they see through you. And they see God on the other side, and God looks big. And when you think about some of the obstacles for people who aren't followers of Jesus. Why aren't they followers of Jesus? Sometimes because Jesus doesn't, or the church doesn't look very appealing. It doesn't look very large. It doesn't look very good. Because I think we make Jesus look small. So when you think about what's going on, to try to be that instrument of magnification, it's I think that's humbling, and it gives you a great sense of respect for people that are on the other side of your voice, and sometimes maybe a whisper is more effective than a shout.
Thank you, Bruce. Here's some sort of specific questions that are about the some of these qualities that go around leadership that we're teasing out now. What would you say are the best leadership qualities for leading well?
I've got my list.
A long pause.
I didn't know you were going to ask this, but when I was thinking about that, years ago, probably 38 years ago, I met a man named Reed Carpenter, who's part of the Leadership Institute out of Pittsburgh, and was introduced to a man named Wayne Alderson. And Wayne was a wonderful, wonderful leader in the steel mills of Pennsylvania. And if you've ever seen the movie or read the book Stronger Than Steel, it was very, very compelling. And Reed opened our eyes to a vision of what leadership looked like and what are leadership qualities. And there were a few, but not so simple. He said, leaders are people of vision. Leaders know how to engage. Leaders have a posture of servanthood. Leaders desire and promote the growth in others. And leaders know what they believe and are committed to those values. I could keep you here for hours fleshing those out. But those are the qualities. And if I could just take a minute and just illustrate it, because I was privileged to know many of the presidents of Wheaton College. Prexy Edmond I knew as a child. And Dr. Edmond, he knew how to engage. If you were a human being, Dr. Edmond just knew how to engage. And engage is a great word, right? The clutch got engaged. You know, so-and-so got engaged over the weekend. The word engagement is just so full of meaning. My father tells a story when he was walking across campus once, and my father taught at Wheaton College before me. And he heard this, Arnie, Arnie, Arnie's looking around. It was Prexy Edmond on the other side of the campus, like 400 yards away, just shouting at him, you know, and so my dad thought, what, you know, and he just, the president came running over and said, sorry, walking, I'll just walk with you a little bit. No point to it other than engaging. Dr. Armening was the president that hired me. And Dr. Armening clearly had a posture of servanthood. Stu Weber, a pastor out on the West Coast, wrote Tender Warrior. Stu Weber tells the story of 11 o'clock one night, he was wrestling with some life issues and about his faith. And he was just sitting in that little courtyard, right? It's on a Blanchard there, doctor. And 11 o'clock at night, and he just seemed, I was at the end of my rope when I heard this voice, can I be helpful to you? And it was Dr. Armitage, working late in the office. On his way home, saw this student sitting there, 11 o'clock at night, seemed to be in turmoil, and said, can I be helpful to you? And invited him for a cup of tea, and from till 12:30 in the morning. He was having tea with the president and just wondering how he could be helpful. That's a posture of servanthood. Dick Chase. Dick, I think as much as anything, desired and promoted the growth in others. And I won't go into all the details, but my professional life would have been radically different had it not been for Dick Chase and his utter commitment to desire the growth and promote the development in and other people. And this man here, person of vision, it's not the what, it's the why that leaders have to answer. And leaders don't have to know what the answers are, but leaders have to know what the questions are. And one of the things that I learned from Dr. Litfin, from watching him, here's a man who understands vision, and he understands vision is about asking the right questions. And not so much about the hows. So he would come to our community and say, you know, what does education at Wheaton mean for the arts? What does education at Wheaton mean for the sciences? What does education at Wheaton mean for faculty-student engagement? And I can't even remember what the answers are, but I remember the questions. So in terms of the qualities of leadership, I've been able to watch those in our presidents.
Let me touch on the essential question. Thank you for that, Bruce. I could speak in return about Bruce as vice chair of the faculty, which is the elected head of the faculty, and our times working together very closely during his stint and all the rest of the time as well. Let me go back to the original question, though. I would like to, I think we need to emphasize, you just really can't hardly talk, you can't say very much about leadership without talking about the context. Because I've been in leadership in a variety of different settings, and they all require very different leadership. The requirement of a senior pastor of a church like this, what effective leadership is here versus what effective leadership is across the street in an academic institution with all the academic aspects of that, working with faculty and the uniqueness of the academic setting, drives, sometimes you get people on the board, businessmen who are absolutely committed to the work of Wheaton College, but the academic world drives them crazy because their business situation could never operate the way this academic thing works. It requires a discussion of the situation. Again, think about the leadership of a surgeon in the operating room. This is not a democracy. This is not a place where there's anything other than do this right now and do it exactly this way. And that's what the patient and the entire team needs from him or her. The situation is so determinative. You say, what's needed of the leader? You almost have to say, well, let's talk about what the situation is, what the group is, what the goal is, the mission is, and then we can talk about what are the leadership needs of this group and this situation and try to think through what's the wisest way to address those needs. Just a touch on Bruce being sort of gently spoken. I've seen him at times when he's not gently spoken and needed to be more forceful. But in a congregational meeting is not the place for that. Here, this is all about the congregation speaking, and his job standing up here is to facilitate the congregation and its work. He's not up here telling the congregation what it's supposed to do or fix it. So that requires a gentle touch. And especially in a congregation of, you know, sort of antsy people, as we all are.
What was that? What kind of people was that again, Duane?
Well, I probably could think of some other adjectives, but I'll just go with that one. But I do think, I've seen Bruce do that, and I think that's true. But you just need to know, in other situations, Bruce is capable of being quite a forceful leader.
Well, what about for a president? You're talking about context specific.
The nature of the one of the reasons my name showed up in the first place, why did the board ever talk to me in the first place about coming to be the president of Wheaton College is that I had spent, I've got the academic credentials, spent those years in the classroom, but also I was a pastor. When I was a professor, I never had any experience in dealing with a board, much less leading a group of a couple thousand people, casting a vision for them, communicating effectively. As a professor, I had the accountability for my own academic work and my students, my classroom, and what's going on there. But I never had experience with these larger things. On the other hand, if I had just been a pastor without the academic, my name would have never come up, because I don't think Wheaton, it would work very well to have someone who wasn't also an academic. And it was those combination of things. So to answer your question, the presidency, that situation requires a combination of a pastoral and an academic dimension, and the ability to put those things together and play both of those roles in the in this very complex thing called an academic institution, where you, the constituency of the students, their parents, donors, the faculty, the governing board, the accreditors, government, all the financial things. I mean, you're answering to so many constituencies and trying to move the institution forward that it's almost a unique type of, let me just say this, there's nothing like the faculty. There's nothing in the church like the faculty. It's a unique entity. I say that having been a faculty member, I often think I was a missionary on the part of faculty to the administration. In academic world, the labor management thing is faculty administration. And you go from faculty over to administration, you've gone over to the dark side, you know? The reality is the faculty is a unique entity. There's nothing like it in the military. There's nothing like it in business. There's nothing like it in the church. The closest you get to it is like an effective hospital, like CDH, where you have the hospital administration. They're running the whole hospital, but you have the docs. They're the ones with the training, the expertise. They're hands-on with the patients. But they're not really running the hospital. The administration and the board are running the hospital. But there is this balancing act then between these roles. Faculty are like the physicians. They have all the education. They're in hands-on with the students in the classroom. There's a unique, and yet they're not the one dictating the budget. The administration is under the in accountability back to the board. And managing that tension is the chief challenge, plus obviously getting the job done for these students with all of that and managing that all forward. You ask, that's a long answer to your question, what is the leadership role over there? And that's it. And it requires a willingness to pay attention to people. You don't, when I came to Wheaton, I did not come there with, the board didn't assign it, and I didn't come with it, a sense of, okay, this is what Wheaton, here's my vision for Wheaton College. When I started, people said to me, what's your vision for the college? And for a year, I said, give me a year or so. I'm gonna spend a year listening and talking and drawing from out of this body of people, faculty, students, alumni, drawing from them a sense and growing in my own understanding, a sense of what we needed to set out to be doing. But that was a group thing where I was pulling from all kinds, the wisdom of the community. But there's a president who has to be able to do that and willing to do that and able to do that in order when you articulate it, then everybody says, yeah, that's it. That's where we need to be going. Let's go. But that came from the group. But part of the skill of that office is you've got to be able to somehow draw that out, articulate it, cast that vision. And if you've done it well and right, the community will gather around it.
Well, that brings me to this question here, which is, I think connected, and also made me somewhat chuckle when I read it at the same time. How do you lead a Christian organization where its members or supporters have strongly held but completely opposite opinions on issues of high importance to the organization?
On issues of what?
High importance to the organization. I suppose that could be true of many Christian organizations, even churches at times. Bruce.
Yeah, it's that's our life, right? And So I've been thinking a lot about the importance of having proper expectations. And when things can get muddled, when expectations are out of whack. So how do you feel when you get a $5,000 hospital bill? Right. Well, if you're expecting a $50,000 hospital bill and you get a $5,000 hospital bill, you're elated. If you're expecting a $500 bill and you get a $5,000 bill, you're devastated. And so part of it is expectations. And I don't know when it, well, I do know when it became obvious to me. I was years ago when I was on an elder council at a different church, we took a vote on a significant matter, and it was, I think, 12 to 1. 12 people saw it one way, and one saw it the other way, and I was the one. And you don't sleep that night. And I did not sleep at all that night. When you're in a room with 12 godly men, 13, and 12 see it the other way. Early the next morning, the chairman of the board called me, and he didn't sleep either. And in the middle of the night, some of what I was seeing was becoming clearer to him. And what he called first of all to say how I was doing. And then he wanted to know if he pushed too hard to sort of get the vote a particular direction. And as we sorted through all that, I became utterly convinced that we were never more united than when we had that vote that went that way. And so you never really know how united you are until you feel things strongly and see it differently. That's really the only test of unity. And so I expect on complicated issues that there are going to be multiple perspectives. And I want to listen, and I want to hear, and I want to understand, and because that's our best shot at seeing the way forward. And I take great comfort that when the people of Israel were trying to discern God's will, they sent out 12 hand-picked men to spy out the land. They all saw the same thing. But 10 of them came back and said, "We're convinced we can't do it." 2 came back and said, "We're convinced that we can." And sometimes that dissenting opinion, that two, those are the ones who actually might see it most clearly. So whenever I see something going 10 to 2 or whatever, I always want to say, who's the two? And if it's men like Joshua and Caleb, I say, whoa, wait a second. You know, we got a majority, but maybe that's not a signal to go forward. So I think the question is, how do you work in a Christian organization when you have strong opinions on different sides? I think, first of all, expect it. Because life is complicated, issues are complicated. People that are thinking well are often going to see different aspects of it. And it's in that repartee, that different perspective, that the best fight for it often emerges. And so I expect it. And then I always want to listen very, very carefully to that minority, because it could be Joshua and Caleb's situation. And then every time you move forward, I want to emphasize as much as possible that just because we don't see it the same way in this particular issue, it doesn't mean that we're not united. We are still followers of Jesus. We don't see this issue particularly the same way, but when we walk out of this room, we're united.
You know, one of the key pieces of that, since we're talking about a Christian organization, is the exhortation to believers to submit yourself one to another, and that we come with a sweet spirit, a Christ-like spirit that is willing to submit ourselves to one another, looking out for the interests of others, not our own interests. We have very clear instruction on that. And I think that ability to submit yourself to others is an important part of living and operating within a Christian organization. We, when I was pastoring a church in Tennessee, again, a church very much like College Church, about same size, same sort of approach to ministry, we implemented at the board level a policy, going to school in the old Baptist policy of the second vote. You know, in Baptist churches, very often in the older Baptist churches, they would take a second vote, the vote of the congregation, and it would turn out to be 80-20. And then I watched Dr. Criswell at First Baptist in Dallas do this one time. The vote came out, I think, 90% to 90%, 10%. And Dr. Criswell says, we're gonna take that vote again. Let's do it again. And the understanding was that if you could, the 10% would submit themselves to the 90%. And sure enough, they took that vote. It was 100%. The people in the congregational meeting had the opportunity to speak up and say they had a chance to vote. But then they were given a chance to submit themselves to one another, to the 90%. And what we did at the board level was that very thing. When we faced something like this, what we would do would take a second vote. And if 13 to 1, all right, let's do that again. And what we're doing is giving the one an opportunity to say, look, I've said I had a freedom to speak up. I've stated my view. But the other 12 are calling it this way. I'm not wise enough, really, or feel strongly enough about this that I need to insist on it. I'm going to submit myself to them, and I will make their decision my decision, and I will own that decision. Let's take that vote again. Comes out 13. And if a person is sitting there, such as Bruce, sitting there saying, I understand that, I want to do that, I'm inclined to do that, but I feel so strongly that this is a wrong decision, we wind up with a 12-to-1 vote again, that is a red flag. We say, don't go there. Let's back up, reconsider, table this, go back. If you've got someone who cannot, a person of maturity and godliness who cannot submit to that, that is a sign the Spirit of God may be tapping you on the shoulder and say, rethink this. And there were times when that happened. But that second vote, there's a lot to be said for that, giving an opportunity for people to submit themselves to one another if they can. And if they can't, then we take that as a sign from the Lord that we need to think more deeply about this. There's a lot to be said for that. But I would go back again to the situational thing about how do you deal with important issues to the institution. It depends on the nature of the issue. Is it a definitional issue? For example, College Church has a statement of faith. Is it something about that statement of faith? How is that going to get handled? That's certainly true at the college. We have a statement of faith, a definition of the institution. That it goes back to the board, and that the president is obligated to maintain the institution. That this, if I'm being challenged on some of those boundary issues, that needs to be handled in a certain way, graciously, godly, wise. But that's not something on which you can compromise. If it's something of a lesser sort, then that if it's a judgment call about buying a piece of property, that's not in the doctrinal statement. There's no verse of scripture that says this is what we should do. That's a judgment call. Well, do you handle that in a different way, particularly in a congregational church? Part of it has to do with the governmental structure of the church that everybody agrees to. That constitution lays this out. Here's how this church makes these kinds of decisions. All right, that will also shape how you handle points of disagreement within an organization. The nature of the issue, the nature of the organization.
Thank you. Here's a question, which is in a way sort of counter what we're doing, but I'm going to ask this one. Is it possible that there is an overemphasis on leadership development within the church these days? How do we ensure we don't prioritize leadership over servanthood? I especially see this in programs designed for young people.
I think it is possible to overemphasize. We turn it into, I think a lot of leadership isn't something really that can be taught, really, it's intuitive, but you can learn a lot by watching others modeling effective leadership and go to school on that. But I do think turning it into something, we're gonna have this course on leadership. I don't want to disavow that. That can be very useful. For example, Max DePree's little book, Leadership is an Art, that's an excellent little book with great wisdom about what it means to be an effective leader. So these things can be taught. But I do think it's possible to overemphasize it.
What would you say, Bruce?
I think we had a great example of it on the men's retreat. I'm trying to think. We studied Hezekiah, and Dr. Ryken was our speaker. So Dr. Ryken is the president of Wheaton College. He's a leader. Was a pastor of a church. Hezekiah was a king. If the word leadership came up, I don't remember it. Some of you men, I noticed, were out there. Did it come up? I don't think it ever came up. But I want to say it was all about leadership. And I went to a session led by Theon Hill, member of our congregation. And I don't know if Theon's here or not. We worked him pretty hard this weekend. But Theon spent an hour with Theon trying to understand, how is it that we can effectively engage groups of people that aren't like us? And the title of it was, workshop was Loving Out Loud. And it was brilliant. And so I sat through this and I thought, wow, this is absolutely fantastic. A little bit like taking a drink from a fire hydrant with a teacup. So afterwards I said, Theon, would you mind if I sat through this session again? Because it was just so rich, and I found my mind just thinking about how do you effectively engage people that aren't like you? And the purpose of understanding this was ultimately so that we can present these people in with authentic Christianity and introduce them to Jesus. So that was what's behind it, which is sort of like we talk about leading people to Christ. So in one sense, it wasn't at all about leadership. And so I think if we just do more of what we're doing on the men's retreat, and help people understand how do you develop a robust vision for what it means to be a follower of Jesus in DuPage County? How do you effectively engage people? Do you really desire and promote the growth and development of other people? What does it mean to be humble in practical terms? What we're doing, I think, is helping followers of Jesus become more aware and probably more effectively positioned to influence other people in ways that are good for their eternal salvation and for making the kingdom on earth more like it is in heaven. Mm-hmm. So I don't think you have to use the L word. You just right. have to kind of do the things that that the church ought to be doing, and it's going to happen.
Best book on leadership?
James McGregor Burns, Leadership.
James McGregor Burns, Leadership?
If you had one book to read on leadership, that's it.
I haven't read it. I need to read it. Duane?
I think I'd go back to that Max DePree book. It's an easier read than Burns. But it's a very wise book on leadership.
Max who?
Max DePree. DePree. Very good little paperback book.
Yep. Why is a leader with a liberal arts background?
He was, by the way, the CEO of... Howard Miller? Herman Miller. Herman Miller. I'm blanking on that. Herman Miller, the furniture company in Michigan, a Christian.
Yeah. This is a question I'm just going to read out. Why is a leader with a liberal arts background easier to follow than a leader who has followed the mechanical educational path of something like a psychological leadership BS and an MA in leadership? You may wish to question the premise of...
No, I definitely want to embrace that premise. But I have to spend the rest of the evening talking here, so I need to be quiet. It brings me into my liberal arts speech. You know, liberal arts have fallen on hard times in America. You live across the street from a militantly liberal arts college, but and elsewhere, you know, higher education is all about, you know, what job can I get? It's job training. It's career preparation. How many times you have a parent say, you know, what job can I get? How much can my student earn with this degree? It all comes down to that. Whereas a liberal arts degree is basically trying to cut yourself free from that mentality. This isn't training for a job, it's education for a life. Medicine is a great example. You know, what the ideal education, from our point of view, I'm speaking now as a liberal arts person, is that broad education you get at liberal arts, then you do the specialization. You go to law school, business school, medical school, dental school, seminary, whatever. That's where you get the training for a job or a career, but you go into it a really broadly and deeply educated person. Otherwise, if you do pre-med, it's all dominant medicine, and then you medical school, and then you go to residence, you come out. I worked with Christian Medical and Dental Society for a decade and a half, working with docs all across the country. And the reality is, many physicians, wonderful, godly Christians, and they're fine physicians, they know medicine, but you get them outside of medicine and their eyes kind of glaze over, they don't know much and aren't all that interested in it. What we want to turn out is very first-rate physicians, but they are broadly educated, deeply educated, and we believe that they will make the best doctors, the best business people, the best, with that kind of a grounding for their professionalized training, job training, career training. So. I think that is the benefit of the liberal arts approach, the broadening, broadly educated person who is highly trained and capable and skillful in a particular area. That's the ideal, it seems to me.
Bruce, do you want to jump in, or yeah.
Yeah, again, this is kind of dear to the core of what we've committed our lives to. In the last couple of years, I've been trying to understand how higher education's lost its way in America. You know, as late as 1870, probably virtually 100% of higher education in the United States, you look at it and you say, well, that's Christian liberal arts. And by today's numbers, if you took liberal arts as a whole, it's less than 0.4% of people in higher education today are attending a liberal arts institution. And if you look at Christian liberal arts as a subset of that, it's less than 0.1%. So I've been trying to understand, how do you go from being like the only form of higher education to virtually becoming extinct? And it's a complex question and it's a much longer answer, but essentially I think that we lost our way when we forgot what it is that we're trying to educate people for. You look at why Harvard was founded and these old mainline schools. We were building a new world. It was a land that was unexplored. It was something totally different than human beings ever knew before. A new day. A new land. And here was a land of opportunity where no matter what station of life you were born to, no matter what the skin color was, no matter what your ancestry was, you could build a new life. And we understood that would go better if we had leaders who really understood what human flourishing look like in all its dimensions. And so we built our Christian liberal arts institutions. And the primary audience was people that were destined to lead in the church. Because we understood that for human beings to flourish, it has to begin in relationship with God. And relationship with God is the only basis for true human flourishing. So, Duane, while it looks broad, I conceive of it as very, very specialized education, focusing on one thing and one thing alone. What does God-centered human flourishing really look like? And we're complex. There's all these different facets to what it means to be a human being. If human beings are going to flourish, we have to understand how we interact with the natural environment around us. So science is important. We have to understand how we interact with one another in groups. So social science is important. We have to understand our history. What's our past? I was talking to a young man not so long ago. What are you doing this week? He said, I'm going back to North Carolina. What are you doing there? I'm going to take my fiance back there. Well, you're not from North Carolina. He says, I'm not now, but that's where I grew up. And I want her to come to my hometown. I want her to visit my high school. I want her to see where I played baseball. And in fact, he just understood that if we're going to build a life together, she needs to know my history. People will often say to me, literature is a waste of time. I say, oh, yeah, sure is. By the way, what's the last good book you read to your dog? What do you mean? You don't read a book to your dog? No, I don't read a book to my dog. Yeah. Well, you read your cat? No, what are you talking about? Well, who do you read to? Well, I read to my children. Well, why do you read to your children? I don't know. All good parents read to their children. You know, we just understand the power of story to engage people. It's through story that values are transmitted. Jesus told a lot of stories. Dr. Litfin tells a lot of stories. And I remember a chapel speech where you just laid out, you know, from the beginning of creation to the eternity, it's this grand meta story. And that's probably where I became convinced that that story is so central to human experience. So everything that is part and parcel of a liberal education is really just another facet of the same thing. What does it truly mean to flourish as a human being? And even though you might not be very artistic, there's going to be an opportunity or a situation that requires creativity. And to be able to draw that out of the people because you understand something of what it means to be creative. So I like to think at Wheaton College we do one thing. We study what does human flourishing really look like. And we began to lose our way when we had Harvard and then we had Harvard Seminary. We had Yale and we had Yale Seminary. And when all our institutions took theology and sent it down the hill and said, oh, you want to do the God thing? That's great. You go to seminary. And when we pulled theology out of the centerpiece of higher education, I think we began to lose our way. Long answer to a short question.
No, that's an important question. Well, we have reached the 7 o'clock hour, and we haven't covered every single one of your questions here. We've covered many of them. If you wrote a question you specifically would like answered, I'm sure these two men will be around for a few minutes afterwards. And perhaps I could just ask if there's something we could be praying about for you.
Strength and steadfastness. I just for strength and to be steadfast.
We can all use that. Let me just hitchhike one 20-second observation. Part of what drives the issue, and those people like us who wax eloquent on liberal arts need to also acknowledge, in fact, to insist on, it's very expensive, and families have to write those checks. I'm very sensitive to that, and I think the economics are driving a lot of what you're talking about. It starts with that loss of a vision of what it means to flourish as humans, but it's also the egregious cost of higher education for families. And people like us, in business and as a president, we have not lost sight of that, believe me. The college wrestles with that every day. For me, I would say I'm at a stage of life, having become the president emeritus. The Lord has freed me up to work on what is really my sweet spot of who I am and what I want to do. I get to get up every morning and do what I want to do, and at the end of the day, I can't believe it's over, and I can't wait to get back at it tomorrow. This is a great privilege to find a spot like that in life at this stage of my life. The Lord has been very gracious. I'm writing, speaking, thinking, reading. That's right kind of on the sweet spot of who I am. All these other things you have to do, yes, but this is the kind of my sweet spot. And so that the Lord would make this a useful and fruitful for the kingdom time in my life.
We will pray in that regard. Thank you very much, Dr. Litfin and Dr. Howard. It's been a pleasure and a great privilege to be able to talk with you about leadership matters.
Thank you.